Welcome to our video service of worship on this fourth Sunday in the season of Easter. We want to thank Pam Asberry for her arrangement and performance of the hymn, My Shepherd Will Supply My Need. And now, please join me in the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Lord God, our Shepherd, Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd and the Paschal Lamb, and the Holy Spirit, who accompanies us all the days of our lives. Amen. Listen to the voice of the shepherd as he calls us to confession. Like sheep who have gone astray, we have not heeded your voice, calling us to follow the right paths, beckoning us to lie down and be restored. We have acted as if our salvation lies in busyness and control. We do not want to be sheep dependent on a good shepherd. We prefer to go it alone, maintaining our fierce independence. Forgive us for rejecting your shepherding care, your love, and your guidance. Forgive us for doubting your presence in times of trouble. Forgive us our despair in the face of seemingly unrelenting evil and death. Lead us back to the path of life. Amen. And now hear these words of comfort and hope from the scriptures. Jesus himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. In the name of Jesus Christ, your good shepherd, you are forgiven. Alleluia.
This morning's greeting is based on Psalm 23. Please join me. Come, walk in green pastures. We follow the shepherd. Come, lie down in green pastures. We trust the shepherd. Come, dine at the table of abundance. We are fed by the shepherd. Come, dwell in God's house. We live abundantly and eternally in the shepherd's care. Please also join me in the prayer of the day. The Lord be with you and also with you. Almighty and eternal God, you have brought back from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep to call us into his flock through his word. Send us your Holy Spirit so that we may hear the voice of the Good Shepherd and faithfully follow him. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First reading on this fourth Sunday in Easter is Psalm 23. Now, I know that many of you have committed this psalm to memory in its King James Version. If you have not, the psalm has been printed in the bulletin that accompanies this video service. And so I invite you to join me now in reciting Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. The Easter Gospel for today comes to us from the 10th chapter of the Gospel of John. Jesus said, Very truly I tell you, Anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of them, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Easter Gospel of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. For the last 5 or 6 weeks, since we have been having these video services of worship instead of worship in person in our worship space, we have not been including anything in our videos specifically for the children. But today is different. I would like to present something now that is intended for children. I don't know how many children we have who worship with their families on Sundays in front of a screen, but if you do have children or grandchildren in your home, I invite you to invite them to come and watch. This is a video that was done a number of years ago. It was done in December of 2015. And it presents the puppet team that my wife directed in my former congregation up in Connecticut. The song that is being presented is called "Love is a Wonderful Thing." And I want you to pay particular attention to two of the backup singers in the song, who are sheep. They were known affectionately as Goodness and Mercy to the members of the puppet team. And Goodness and Mercy, of course, make an appearance in the 23rd Psalm. The song is not particularly about shepherds or sheep, but it is about love, the wondrous gift of God's love, particularly the love of the shepherd who cares for us and attends to our needs. Please enjoy "Love is a Wonderful Thing."
Better than me. The sun shines, the dawn has white.
And now, would you please pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts collectively be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is the fourth Sunday in the season of Easter. And on the Christian calendar, the fourth Sunday of Easter is always known as Good Shepherd Sunday. The prominent themes in our readings today are of shepherds and sheep, by which I think we are supposed to envision our relationship with the Lord, our shepherd, and Jesus Christ, our good shepherd. And I think as we hear the setting of these passages, the pastoral setting and the relationship between the shepherd and the sheep, we find comfort and peace. We find the images to be very pleasing. We can almost close our eyes and envision ourselves living in that setting, enjoying that relationship, that closeness between ourselves and the shepherd who leads us and takes care of us. But the reality is that very few of us here have any firsthand knowledge of that relationship or that way of life. We know nothing about the life of shepherds and meadows, sheep and sheepfolds. My wife, Deb, and I were married almost exactly 33 years ago over Memorial Day weekend in 1987. It's hard to imagine that it's been that long, but it has been. And after we were married, we went on a honeymoon, of course. But we went north. Most couples, after they get married, go south for their honeymoons, to warmer climes, to the beach or to the Caribbean. But we crossed the border into Canada. And specifically, we visited Nova Scotia and New Brunswick, taking a day to tour and sightsee on Prince Edward Island. And I have to tell you that I have never seen grasses as lush and green as I saw that day that we spent on Prince Edward Island. At one point, we were driving down a road looking, I think, for a lighthouse. And this road was surrounded on either side by farmland and lush green pastures. And we came upon a section of pasture where sheep were out grazing. And Deb asked me to pull over to the side of the road so she could take a picture. Deb and I, of course, have always been city dwellers. And so a pastoral image like this was something that was rather unknown to us. And we wanted to capture it on film. So I pulled over to the side of the road as she asked. Deb rolled down the window, poked her head out the window, and went, "Baa!" at the sheep. And as if on cue, the sheep raised their heads from the grass that they were grazing upon, turned and looked directly at my wife as she snapped the photograph. Now, I've always heard that sheep are dumb animals, but if these sheep really could not tell the difference between my wife's bleating and one of their own, then it certainly must be true that sheep are not very bright. But then, do you really want to hear a sermon about shepherds and sheep, something with which we have really no experience, something about which I, as the preacher, have no firsthand knowledge of this symbiotic relationship that allegedly exists between shepherds and their sheep? Do you really want to be compared to these stupid, wayward animals? I didn't think so. So what I've decided to do today instead is to dwell on the final words in today's gospel reading, the final promise that Jesus makes, where he says, "I came so that they may have life and have it abundantly." And one of the questions I think would come to our minds immediately is what did Jesus mean by this abundant life he promises to give us? Is this a life that is free of trouble, a life filled with ease, a life of good health, plenty to eat, enough wealth so that we feel reasonably secure and contented with our lives, so that we can take advantage of leisure opportunities that come our way, a life of more of everything that we always wanted, more stuff. Is that the abundance that Jesus is talking about in this gospel reading? Well, I think in order to begin answering that question, we should start to examine the setting in today's gospel reading. And it is true that Jesus does talk about a symbiotic kind of relationship between the shepherds and the sheep. The sheep know the shepherd's voice and will only follow him. The shepherd leads the sheep out and guides them, cares for them, and protects them. Jesus also refers to himself in this passage as the gate through which the sheep come in and go out and find pasture, nourishment. However, Jesus also speaks of thieves and bandits who break in to steal and kill and destroy, we are told. So the setting in today's gospel reading reflects two aspects of life, those indeed that we find comforting and pleasing, and those that are threatening and potentially dangerous. And I believe that both aspects of life are also clearly reflected in the 23rd Psalm. I think it goes without saying that the 23rd Psalm is probably the best known and best loved passage of Scripture, even for Christians. Perhaps especially for Christians. And I think if you ask anyone why they love the 23rd Psalm, they would tell you that they find it to be comforting. The setting, of course, is very pleasing and peaceful. The imagery of lying down in green pastures and strolling beside still waters. It brings a sense of comfort and peace to us. It also helps us, I think, oftentimes to recall memories of those times when we have been most contented in our lives. Like this story that was shared by a woman in my former congregation as part of a Bible study. She talked about a trip she made 1 year to Iceland. Now, I have to be honest with you, Iceland has never been on my bucket list of places to visit. Although the woman did assure everyone in the Bible study group the night she told this story that the scenery in Iceland is absolutely breathtaking. And I have heard that from other people who have visited Iceland. She said that she met a friend on this tour that she was taking. And that she traveled around, particularly with this one friend, and saw many of the sights in Iceland. One day, they got off the tour bus together and took a little hike. They climbed up this steep hillside, and when they got to the top, they found themselves in a wide-open meadow filled with lush, green, tall grasses. And curiously, she and her friend decided to lie down in those grasses for the better part of an hour. And the woman admitted to the Bible study group that she really didn't know at that point in her lives much about the 23rd Psalm. She didn't know the corresponding verses to that psalm, but she knew the imagery of lying down in green pastures. And she said that during that hour or so, that she and her friend lay down in those grasses, quiet. They experienced a close communion with God. So they experienced almost what it might be like to be in relationship to the Lord, our shepherd. However, the thing that I find to be the most useful about the 23rd Psalm is that it presents a balanced picture of life. There are those delicious times of lying down in the green pastures and strolling beside the still waters, metaphorically speaking. But then the psalm also speaks about the dark valley, which the King James Version of this psalm refers to as the valley of the shadow of death. And if we are truthful with ourselves, we spend a significant part of our lives in the valley of the shadow of death, in the dark valley. Yeah. Indeed, think about the setting in which you and I most often hear the 23rd Psalm. It's the Christian funeral service. Words that people find to be particularly comforting and hopeful at a time when there has been a death. Indeed, this past Monday afternoon, I performed the commendation of the dying for Debbie Teal and her brother Ray once they learned that their mother, Betty Richardson, was near death. And we began that prayer liturgy by reciting the 23rd Psalm together. We have a number of people within our congregation who right now are in this valley of the shadow of death, who are experiencing the grief and the sadness and the loss that accompany the death of someone who is dear to them. I've already mentioned Debbie Teal and Ray. Betty Richardson did indeed die this past week on Wednesday evening late. And just yesterday, we held the graveside service for Betty Richardson. And then, of course, there's also the Hernandez family. Most of you know that Norma Hernandez, for whom we have been praying for months now in her battle against breast cancer, died this past Monday morning. And so the members of that family, her husband and her six children, one of whom is not quite a year old, find themselves traversing the dark valley, the valley of the shadow of death, a valley of grief and sadness and loss. And I dare say that they probably will find themselves to be in this valley for quite some time, for weeks and perhaps for months before they emerge into a new and more hopeful existence as a family. And of course, we could look at our present situation and I think easily picture ourselves traveling through, journeying through a dark valley. The COVID-19 pandemic, I think, can easily be described as a time of darkness for all of us. And we don't know how long this journey through the dark valley is going to take and what the long-term impact of this epidemic will be on our lives in this country and, of course, worldwide. But then the psalm also promises us that the Lord is with us as we journey through the dark valley. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort. These are images of the protection of the shepherd. The Lord also promises to set a table for us in the presence of our enemies. Now this is an image that we find quite often in the Psalms. You will hear the psalmists speak of enemies, but you're never entirely certain what the psalmist is referring to. Are these human adversaries? Well, they very well might be, but then it could also be a metaphor for disease, impending death, or other adversities that we face in life. But the Lord sets a table for us, prepares the things we need, the nourishment that we need in order to survive as we encounter these difficulties in our lives. The Lord's goodness and mercy, we are promised, will follow us all the days of our lives. The grace and mercy of our Lord God will fill our cup to overflowing. These are the promises of abundance that come to us in today's scripture readings. So it has to be clear to us by now that Jesus is not offering us a life of ease that is filled with everything we've ever wanted, all that we could dream or hope for, all of the abundant wealth and all of the accumulations we might want for our lives. This is not, clearly not, what Jesus has in mind. He is talking about an abundance that comes to us in the midst of all that is happening in life. in the midst of our strolls through the green pastures and beside the tranquil waters and through the dark valley as well. God's abundance comes to us as the shepherd cares for our needs, even in times of difficulty and struggle, of which there are many for all of us, I think. The abundance has to do with our relationship with the Good Shepherd. He provides for us, he protects us, and he cares for us in the midst of all that we are experiencing in life. And there is an intimacy to this relationship, a close personal connection between us and the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what he is offering us in today's gospel. Now, the one thing that we cannot confuse the promise of abundant life with is the other promise that comes to us from the gospel, the promise of eternal life. Because abundant life is not some far-off future hope that we have, that at the conclusion of our difficult journey through this veil of tears, we will receive abundant life in an eternal form. That this is not what Jesus is talking about. Abundant life can be ours in the present. It's an abundance that we experience here and now in the midst of all that is going on in the world and in our lives. And this is a word, I think, that provides us with great comfort and hope, particularly right now. Of course, we do have the promise of eternal life that comes to us. John's gospel speaks of eternal life often. And indeed, this is something that comes to us not because we have trudged through the dark valleys of life through our faith and our determination and will and come to the end. And then as a reward for our faithfulness and our determination, God grants us eternal life in his kingdom. That is the way the promise of eternal life is often presented to us Christians. No, it comes to us as a gift and a blessing, the goodness and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. As we journey through life, through the green pastures beside the still waters, and through the many dark valleys we encounter, we come to a place where we inherit the promise that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Abundant life and eternal life are ours through our faith, through our symbiotic personal relationship with our good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we have a special treat for you this morning. We welcome David and Kathy Burfield, who will be performing our special music, a song entitled Goodness, Love, and Mercy.
Oh Lord, you're my shepherd. You make me lie in fields of green. You lead me by the still waters. You restore righteousness for me. Though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil thing, for you are with me and you comfort me. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Oh Lord, you're my shepherd, you make me lie in fields of green. You lead lead me by the still waters. You restore righteousness to me. Though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil thing. For you are with me, and you comfort me.
Now I invite you to join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now we invite Perry Moss, who will lead us in the prayers of the church.
Reveal yourself to us as our risen Lord Jesus in all aspects of our lives, in the green pastures, beside the still waters, and in the dark valleys of life. Receive the prayers of your church on behalf of the whole creation as we say, Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. You know your own, and your own know you, good shepherd of the sheep. Guide the church in gentleness and peace, that we may obey your commandment to love one another and live out that love in truth and action. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. In the resurrection of Jesus, God has triumphed over all powers and dominions and revealed the way of love to be the way of life. Visit those who exercise authority in our nation and in the world, Almighty God, and grant them a sense of devotion that they would shepherd their people, care for them compassionately, protect and guide them responsibly. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. You have given your life to the protection of your people. Open our eyes to see our brothers and sisters' needs throughout the world, and then empower us to respond with generous help to feed your sheep, whom within and outside of this faith community. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. You have given us green pastures and clear still waters, Lord our Creator. Impassion and empower us to work for the protection of our natural world, even as the Good Shepherd accompanies and protects all of us, his sheep. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. Hear us as we bring the prayers of our hearts to you, O gracious one, remembering especially Vern and Charlotte Rink and those who keep in our hearts. Hear our prayers for those who have walked through the valley of the shadow of death, especially Norma Hernandez and her family, and Betty Richardson and her family. Grant that we may dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. Reassure our hearts, O God, with the comfort of your guiding presence, that we may know that you are with us and we will fear no evil. Strengthen us to join in the Spirit's work of leading all people into your divine, abundant love, that goodness and mercy may follow us all the days of our life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Now let us join praying the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now let us exchange our signs of peace and reconciliation with those in our homes with whom we may have had conflict in the previous week. Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." The peace of our risen Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Once again, we welcome David and Kathy Burfield, who will be singing a song entitled "Never Walk Alone."
As my heart beat, you won't forsake me. You are the love that will carry me, and I won't be afraid. I will trust your heart and say, I will never, ever, never walk alone. You are with us, for us, always holding on. Though I wonder, your love goes further. You are my hope and my future. I will never walk alone. Questions may haunt us, casting a shadow. Still, you're the hope and the fire in me. I will not tremble, I will not stumble. You are my courage, my bravery, and I won't be afraid. I will trust your heart and say, I will never, ever, never walk alone. You are with us, for us, always holding on. Though I wonder, your love goes further. You are my hope and my future. I will never walk alone. Surely your goodness and mercy will light up way set before me. Surely your grace will pursue me all my days. I will never, ever, ever walk alone. You are with us, for us, always holding on. I will never, never, never walk alone. You are with us, for us, always holding on. Though I wonder, your love goes further. You are my hope and my future. I will never walk alone. I will never walk alone. I will never walk alone.
And now please receive this blessing. Go now with your trust in the Good Shepherd, and let us love, not in words, but in truth and action. Believe in the name of Jesus Christ and love one another just as he has commanded us to do. And may God be at your side even in the valleys of death. May Jesus Christ fill your cup with abundant life to overflowing. And may the Holy Spirit abide in you and tend you with love and mercy all the days of your life. Amen.